Welcome to Mag's Mind. I'm your host, Zach Weismann. We'll be exploring current trends in impact, work, life, and community. In the meantime, we invite you to sit back, listen in, and come sail away with us. Today, I'm joined by good friend and managing director of Adaptive Change Advisors, Eric Martin. Eric's also one of our founding MAG members. In this episode, Eric and I are going to be discussing life, grief, and even death, and how this can be a powerful tool in work and business. Hey, Eric.
Hey, Zach. It's great to be with you today.
Likewise. Thanks for being our first official podcast guest. I know that probably ranks pretty high in your esteemed honors list.
It really does, Zach. No kidding aside. This is not only is this a great topic to be talking about today with all that's going on, but I do think that MAG and the work that you've been doing, and I suppose I could say the work that we've been doing, is just a viable and highly relevant vehicle to be bringing this kind of conversation forward. So it's a great honor. So thank you again for the opportunity.
But I know, Eric, and you know, in some of our past conversations, there's this notion you've articulated to me about almost kind of the power that death and grief can hold, and in the framework of creating change. And you know, I think culturally, environmentally, we're seeing this from so many different perspectives, right? Where the climate news is very real, been very serious for quite some time, causing a lot of questions. Obviously, we have the COVID-19 pandemic right now that's, again, causing a lot of anxiety, unknown, uncertainty, literal death, anxiety about death. And, you know, I think while it's a heavy conversation, I think it's something that's very real and things that people go through in various ways, you know, from a company getting laid off and the loss of a job or the loss of a business going under, or, you know, loss of way of life, which we're seeing right now, and, you know, loss of a loved one, which I've personally gone through with my mom, you know, and how there is, I think, with all this change, like, how do we come out the other end? Okay. How do we come together and, you know, through the lens of leadership, how do we get through all of this?
Yeah. I love that you're starting with a light topic for your first podcast, Zach.
Thank you. Yes.
No, but I mean, these are the critical and meaningful questions of our time, as you said, with, you know, things that are happening in the environment right now. These are the critical questions of our lives in many ways, and also the critical questions of leadership. So, you know, where to begin? It's a big question. Let me just lay out a couple of thoughts and see where that might take us. And I'll start with this question of leadership, just because, you know, that is the point of view that I often bring to these conversations. But I do want to transition that into the conversation about loss and death and grief. So when I talk about leadership, I'm talking about not just what happens in your head. It's not just about vision. It's not just about providing a sense of direction and clarity about who should be doing what and all that good stuff. That's important to leadership, but it's just a tool. It's just a resource for leadership. So when I talk about leadership, I'm talking about, you know, stuff that happens below your neck, or it's stuff that happens in your heart. Mm. It's in your gut. It's who you are, that sense of identity. And so I lead with that, Zach, because for this question of what is the role of the gut and the heart and this stuff that's below the neck in leadership necessarily brings us to questions of loss. And, you know, one thing that we see when people who are trying to lead change that's consequential and that's meaningful, that is going to change the status quo in some way, that they immediately run into resistance. And that resistance can be outright resistance and attack. It could be subtle and somewhat subversive or passive aggressive, but they're going to meet some kind of wall. And one way to think about that when it happens, and this goes for people who are working in organizations as well as in your personal life, that that resistance isn't about the change per se. What it's about is a sense of loss. And people, what they're resisting is loss, having to give up something. And you mentioned some of that earlier on, giving up a sense of comfort, of routine, of course, power and control get thrown in there, but even those are not sophisticated enough diagnoses to understand the loss that people are averting. So we can talk more about that. But I mentioned loss because how we process loss has a lot to do with how we manage grief and despair and even death. And so I don't know about you, but my experience growing up and also now getting older with family members and others who are, you know, getting to the latter stages of their life, is that when we don't process that grief, when we don't find a place to talk about it, that the grief and despair, the loss doesn't go away. It just kind of builds up and then it eventually erupts. And what happens when we repress that grief or turn away from it in different ways is that our heart hardens. And so a hardened heart, if you take on board this notion of leadership that I just laid out, a hardened heart is not a conducive place to lead from, nor is it conducive to opening us up to life and possibilities. So we have this lifetime of practice in shutting down sorrow and shutting down grief and stopping those feelings. And in a sense, there's a certain wisdom in that because of the way that many of us, and I'm speaking here as a white man, are asked to process sorrow. And it's often doing it alone. It's often doing it in shame. And so, you know, there's maybe for some people, some listeners, there's a big leap between what it takes to lead people through change and uncertainty and this question of grief and despair and loss. But I do think they're very closely connected.
And something about it sounds like that the hardening over time, whether through suppression or, you know, if you go through a tragic event or whether personal life, professional life, that it's almost like you're saying that hardening can have unintended consequences down the road, which could affect lots of things, relationships, again, work, an openness to an inclusive environment and economy. Is that how I'm understanding that correctly?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, this is, you know, it's still new terrain for me, to be honest. But I think that's right. It has consequences for our ability to be available for people as they go through change. And I think it comes from maybe a fear that if we enter into that despair, that grief, that we will wallow in it. You know, we're told just to get over it. Get over it. I'm reminded of a woman that I worked with in one of my leadership workshops who was who told us a pretty poignant story of how about 15 years earlier, she had lost her husband to cancer when she had a one-year-old child, their first child at home. And she said that, you know, many people said to her at the time, they didn't say get over it, but they said, you know, you're still young. You have a whole life ahead of you. Mm. And the insinuation was that she would find love again and that it was okay to move on. And what she said in this workshop to all the participants, it was a really poignant moment for the group as they were working deeper questions around their own organizational leadership. But her personal example, I think, brought this point of loss home. What she said was, she said, she realized that you never get over the loss. You can't just put it behind you. Instead, she said, it becomes part of who you are. It becomes part of your identity, not in a wallowing sense, but in the sense that, okay, now I feel whole because I've taken this data point, I've taken this experience, this grief, this loss into my life, into my world. And, you know, I don't know about you, but when I do that, you know, and I've had experiences with my dad growing up being sick and eventually dying at a young age. Mm-hmm. But when I allowed myself to really be present to that grief, to that loss, to that despair, it wasn't a dead state. It actually, for me, brought me more in contact with life than many other times in my life. And so, you know, this fear that we might wallow in it and get stuck in it, I think is unfounded in some respects.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, and thank you for sharing. And I agree. I mean, as you know, but maybe new to many of our listeners is, yes, yeah, me personally losing my mom to cancer in a similar mm-hmm. sense. And, you know, being 28 at the time and her being extremely healthy and active, and she was 60 years old and got diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer and was gone in 4 months, if 4 months, really three. And, mm-hmm. you know, such a all hands on deck time period that you really couldn't process what was going on. But in that grief and loss, yeah, I mean, when you're thrust into it and you don't have the choice, you really almost, to your point, have to embrace it. And I think for me, what really kind of happened personally was it had been such a stressful time mentally and physically, but primarily mentally, right? Trying to research and understand and help and caregive, that then months mm-hmm. later, my body caught up physically. And then I started having panic attacks, you know, like leg shaking. Yeah. And I had never experienced that before. And after, yeah. you know, you feel like you're having a heart attack. And after about three or four of these, there was a distinct moment I remember where I could say, I said, I have to get a grip on this. Like, this grief is either going to literally eat me alive, or I can use it as motivation. I can use it as a tool to become part of me and frame it in the right way and use it as motivation. Mm-hmm. You know, and did, but it does. It there's something about that change,
yeah.
and the going through that process and the fear of the unknown, which I think relates to a lot of the, you know, the global issues we're seeing. There's a resistance to that, you know, and yeah. a fear of that. But then when you're thrust into it, or if you have the proper tools, or you go through it at the right time, you can definitely mm-hmm. come out much stronger. But again, yeah, the number, you know, I had very much that same resistance that one of your colleagues had of, you know, people saying, well, you'll get over this, you know, and you'll go back to normal and you'll move on. And I couldn't figure out for the longest time why I kept rejecting that language of move on. And I realized it was because, mm-hmm. no, you don't move on, you move forward. Right. And there's a big difference. And I think you can again see that, I think, in a business landscape, especially when we're talking yeah. about really trying to solve big problems. Like, there's a lot of focus on move yeah. on, but not a lot of focus on move forward. I don't know if that kind of resonates with what you're seeing as well.
It does, yeah. Yeah, and that leap to move on, to leap to action without really sitting with the moment, I think, is one of the mistakes we see in leadership, too, not just in this personal domain. There's something also, you and I were talking about this a little bit earlier before we hopped online here, about the need in the bigger issues that we face in life to hold both the hope and be optimistic about that, but also hold the reality of the moment.
Right.
And one way I think about this is, you know, it's holding the optimism, but not letting it slip into naivete on the one hand. And on the other hand, holding the current reality, but not letting it slip into despair.
Nihilism.
Or pessimism and right. nihilism, right.
Yeah.
And it's like that with leadership work too, if I could just draw that connection, is you see a lot of people who, when they're leading change, all they want to talk about is the bright, sunny future, the mm-hmm. vision, the promised land. And we need to hold that space. That's really what helps us get out of bed in the morning and anchor to something that's full of purpose and light. But on the other hand, we need to have an honest conversation about the current reality, the way things are today, which might be being in that pit of despair. And I guess conversely, some people like to talk about the current reality and everything that's wrong and how they're, you know, how it's terrible, and actually don't hold that optimistic, brighter side. So the work of leadership includes having an honest conversation with yourself, as well as with your team and others, about both the current reality and the aspiration. And then holding those two things in a, and holding the tension, because there's often mm-hmm. a tension between those two things and this drive to move toward the aspiration, but not spend enough time perhaps in the current moment or in the journey toward there. But holding that tension in a creative and life affirming way, Because Parker Palmer once talked about it that way, and that really resonates with me.
We feel that. I know a lot of MAG members feel that, and I know individuals all feel that, you know, in so many different ways right now. And there's, I think your point about tension is so spot on, because if you work in healthcare, if you work in social impact, if you work in technology, it is. It's, if you work in sustainability, it's really easy to go down those rabbit holes of despair, right? The media coverage, the reports that are coming out, you know, I think I kind of went through that over the holidays with climate change, really said, well, this is not looking good. But how do you hold that similar to grief and turn that into fuel? And like you're saying, right, not let it cause inaction, not let it cause preconceived notions or stereotypes or blame. And then how do you use it as fuel? But then, right, how do you then also feel like you're doing enough or you're doing your part? And everybody defines that differently. And of course, there's can be levels of almost hypocrisy there. But if you are working in an area of change, yeah, how do you also then feel like you're actually shifting the needle? Because in the grand scheme of things, maybe you did, maybe you didn't. But I think what I'm hearing you say is part of that is holding that tension of these issues are very serious, but I'm in here. I'm in the arena, the man in the arena, woman in the arena fighting. And then when you're fighting, you need some reward. You need to know that your efforts are paying off. Is that kind of how you view that tension as well?
Yeah, I do think we need to see some or experience some kind of progress to, you know, if nothing else, just to help us hold steady. But I do think it's a delicate balance, because the, and again, I'm speaking from personal experience, but also working with people who are going through change, that, you know, even grief itself can become a race. You know, am I doing this well? You know, the kind of
am I doing this fast enough?
Fast enough, and yeah, am I too depressed? It kind of becomes another form of self-aggression in some ways, like many self-help type things do. And so, you know, I do think there's a natural inclination for many people, not all, to move on. And I think that lean into progress is probably more common than really allowing the grief to wash over you. And I think that's where I tend to, you know, at least in my work, hold the attention a bit longer than might be comfortable. Because the reality is, you know, everything we love, we will lose. And it may not be death in life. It could be illness. It could be the loss of a home. It could be the loss of a pet. The other things that we've become bonded to.
Right. A
way of doing business.
A way we used to make money. Sure. Yeah.
A way we used to make money. A value proposition we're attached to a client or a partner relationship that we knew how to navigate competently. You know, that loss of a sense of competence can be one of those things that we have to grieve. And yet, in society, the only grief that is formally acknowledged is, for the most part, the loss of a, you know, of a person. You know, I'm sorry for your loss, we say to people. Mm-hmm. We don't really say that when it comes to these other things in a way that has the same, I don't know, the same level of empathy. So there's a sense, I think, in corporate America and organizations that there's something missing around this process of grief. And as I mentioned, holding people through loss and pacing that loss with people is a key part of leading change. Yeah, I don't know what your experience has been, but I think that because people have experienced so much unacknowledged, unaddressed, unhonored loss in their professional careers, that maybe sometimes that leads to these secondary fillers, you know, things like rank and wealth and professional identity and, you know, and even things like comparative shopping. You know, these things kind of try to take the place of the belonging in the community and the other things that really are the only things that can fill that space. You know, I don't think we can actually grieve alone. I think it is a community process. It's always been a community process. And only until recently has it become this individual phenomenon that we're expected to hold on our own in this bold, you know, strong, independent model of leadership. So I think we start with the premise that, you know, the change is constant, and then really develop the skill set to anticipate the change, prepare ourselves, and hold others to that. The seemingly dramatic, or well, the unnecessarily dramatic shifts in organizational strategy or what have you wouldn't have to be so dramatic after all.
Right.
Yeah. So there's a lot we can learn from everyday life. But then on the flip side, also a lot we can bring from our experience of change in professional realm into our personal lives too.
Oh, couldn't agree more. And I think your comment about, you know, right, how does that factor into things like comparative culture or keeping up with the Joneses or focusing on finances? Yeah. So spot on. And I think, you know, we'd be remiss to not comment on the role of technology in that, you know, and that'll be a podcast episode on its own. But there is the, you know, I think professionally you see, you know, you only hear about from a social media lens, you really only hear about the good stuff or the maybe really bad stuff, you know, and it can create this fear that I'm falling behind or I'm, you know, not doing enough or I'm not okay. And because people aren't giving a full perspective, you know, they're given, you know, hey, I just got a new job, but they're not telling you that they got laid off from their previous job. You know, and they're not feeling,
right,
to your point too, okay to be okay with, they're not feeling supported enough to be okay not being okay, if that makes sense, and being understanding and processing that layoff and that's part of life to some degree. And then there's a focus on, great, well, I can't wait to now, you know, share with the world that I got a new job. And we're all guilty of it. I don't think it's passing blame. I just think it's worth pointing that system through social media, through technology, I think, to your point, exacerbates a lot of that too, that it creates that experience of, you know, self-absorption and not keeping up with the Joneses, so to speak. You know, I sometimes look back at school, for example, from elementary school to middle school to high school, and I don't know what I was doing, but I apparently was doing something right because I seemed to get a handful of awards, one including, I kid you not, it was called the Tall Texan Scholarship. It was literally a scholarship for being tall and a good person. No, you couldn't be tall and a jerk. But I walked into the interview and they measured you literally against the wall to see how tall you were, to see if you qualified. And, you know, you just sort of think about that from in a school system, sports, there's an award for everything. And I think when you sort of get out into the quote unquote real world, it's like a free for all. There's less structure. There's less, you know, you're not getting a grade and there's debates around sort of the grading system, but how do you know where you are in your own journey? And I don't want to kind of get us too off topic, but I think it is related to feeling like you're a little bit adrift and then also seeing the news of, you know, everything in the news, COVID and the environment, and then maybe having professional, personal grief, you can see how, right, one would want to shut it off or ignore it or suppress it, like you said before, and get cold-hearted.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm tempted to ask if you got a plaque of some sort for your tall scholarship, and I'm still waiting for my short kid scholarship. I was, you know, that was the opposite for you, but
it was about a 6 foot four trophy.
right, life size. Put that on the top shelf.
We're curious how that resonates with you. Do you feel that tension between work and life, technology and keeping up with the Joneses? If so, let us know. We want to hear from you.
So, and there's a lot in what you just said. And I think, you know, maybe just to pick up on what I think is underlying perhaps what you just said is maybe the feeling of shame, you know, the loss of a job, the acknowledgement for being who we really are. I mean, that's another form of grief, is these parts of ourselves that we lost. You know, it could be a loss of integrity, wholeness, the inability to move in the world as we are, not just as we need to appear to get that next job or look good on LinkedIn or what have you. There's kind of this grief shame, as it were, or a grief terror experience that we have. It's rarely a pure grief experience, which again, I think is quite beautiful. But, you know, you mentioned COVID-19. I guess maybe we should touch on that because that's a different kind of grief and loss. Mm-hmm. You know, it brings up kind of this loss of how things were supposed to be. You know, my 401k should have been X, or, you know, I don't know about you, but I've had a whole host of workshops and trainings, conferences, you know, that just canceled, hopefully postponed, but there's no guarantee of that even. Mm-hmm. So that loss of a sense of, gosh, it's not supposed to be this way. It was supposed to be something else. And that requires its own form of grieving, not to mention the people who are really suffering. I have an uncle right now who's preparing to go into chemotherapy, and none of us can see him in the hospital because of COVID-19. But I think one of the, you know, one of the, perhaps, I don't know, but one, I think our lives are actually much more public now with this virus. You know, it's not unheard of, at least in my neighborhood, to be talking about the sniffles and sneezes and how are you feeling, and not even in a way where you're trying to kind of, you know, in a sneaky way, find out if they're sick or not, so you should stay away, because it's kind of presumed you will stay away anyway, for now at least. But it's really just an empathetic, like, wow, I hope you're not going through that. And we all kind of fear that happening to us. So this, it used to be, I think, that we always knew what was up with our neighbors or friends. You knew your neighbors. Mm-hmm. And that's changed. You know, I think we live in a society now, many of us at least here in the West and in the US, who don't know our neighbors. We don't, and worse than that, in some ways, we don't need to know them. We're not dependent upon them for our livelihood, for our sense of community and belonging. In fact, we're probably more dependent upon the, you know, the supply chain going back into China, as we see now with what's happening with the economy, than our neighbor. And so in a way, I think this COVID phenomenon is a chance to reclaim some of that community. And, you know, and I think that's going to be needed on the other side, regardless of what happens with the virus. It's needed for a sense of community, belonging, and whatever the next kind of, you know, crisis may be. So, I think that, you know, when these deeply important parts of life become public, not in the sense of the whole world knowing it, but in the sense of sharing in it with others, it opens up these new forms of community. It's kind of a threshold moment, I think, for some people.
That's really interesting. Yeah. And I think it ties back to your comment about, if not handled properly, grief and anxiety can cause one to put up walls. And where I think we've been doing that, to your point, almost unknowingly with the rise of technology and not knowing our neighbor. You know, we've been putting up those walls. Well, I've got, you know, 8,000 Facebook friends. Why do I need to know the person living next to me who could maybe save my life? You know, but how, if you
I have 300 Facebook friends, Zach, so I'm always feeling jealous.
Well, I actually deleted Facebook, but that, again, that's another conversation. But but the grief process, like, you know, me going through it personally, you could feel, if you didn't get to a point where you felt okay to have those tough conversations, to create a space to tell someone you're not feeling okay, or in the case of what we're seeing right now, to be okay to say, I'm nervous about all of this, or this is causing me a lot of anxiety, or to have a conversation at a company and say, I'm nervous that our business may not survive this. If you suppress that, then the consequences can vastly outweigh what, you know, the maybe the uncomfortableness or the difficulty in that conversation, right? Because you get a hardened heart, or you don't face a challenge, or you become, you know, exclusive instead of inclusive. I mean, that's kind of how I think, to your point about what's going on with coronavirus, is, it's really scary, and it's happening, but we have to have the ability to still have dialogue, and, you know, okay for somebody to express their fears or anxiety about this, or then we begin to shut ourselves off. And then that's, I think, where either in grief or in anxiety, then blame starts to come in. You know, you start to question things and point fingers. And then I'm sure in your work too, and in our work, that happens in businesses too, and in work.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think because we don't work with the loss that and the grief and death that's present every day, we trudge this stuff around with us. We take it into our workplace. I think most of the people that come, not necessarily most, but many people who come to me for work you know, to work with them through change, are, you know, have not actually done the work themselves to know how to sit with this. And I think the very fact that you feel grief means that you're still connected. It means you have not completely cut off. You're still alive.
Right.
And that's great news, because that ache in your heart becomes a bit of a homing beacon. You know, it's a way you can, if you learn to trust that, it can, I think, guide you on that next step when you're going through uncertainty and you're not quite sure where to go. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a form of protest too against a system, a world perhaps that, you know, would prefer to see us not feel that grief. I don't, you know, mm-hmm. for me, there's this one. I was in the car the other day, a year or so ago, with my daughter, who at the time I think was about 7 years old. It was just after one of the hurricanes had blown through New York here. We're in New Jersey, but it took down some of these old, beautiful oak trees, 150 years old or so. And as I'm driving down the street with my daughter in the back of the car, or just in the back seat, not the back of the car.
That would be illegal.
That would be illegal. You could take that out of the audio here. I said to her, "Oh my gosh, look at that." And she said, "I know, Dad, the trees are dying." I thought, how did she know? I didn't even get there, but it was one of those things that bothers me so much. It was so visible to her. And you see, you know, some things that really just pierce me. You see these, I don't know if you've come across this in the news, but there are people who are creating wood chips, you know, to burn in so-called, in, you know, environmentally friendly kind of energy production facilities. And these guys will come and they'll hand a farmer a check, you know, say somewhere in South Carolina, big fat check, and then they pull this big machine.
The wood chipper.
It just the wood chipper, and it's going above these 200-year-old oaks, and it's spending 10 seconds just pulverizing it to wood chips, like that. Yeah. That kind of, like, how do you do that? How do you do that? Whether or not you even love trees, to see something like that happen in 10 seconds, you have to be really cut off from life and cut off from an experience of grief. And I feel for those people. It's not that they're bad people; they're doing their job, and the families, you know, of course, are doing what they need too. But that's where I think, you know, really being in touch with these emotions can be a form of protest and a refusal to live numb and to live small. So I think it's really important that we do this work, which again is why I'm so thrilled that you're bringing this question to the fore at the beginning of a podcast. If we have that conversation, it lays, I think, a bit of a groundwork for us to be able to have other more strategic conversations around business, or, you know, questions about how do you lead change even in your personal life.
Right. Right. No, that's a really good point. And thank you for that story. Yeah. I think, yeah, if you're just telling everyone to move on, you know, if a friend lost a loved one and you just told them it'll be okay, you'll move on, you know, they're not going to react to that well. And similarly, we have to look at that from the lens of the issues we're facing, from health, from the environment, from businesses, from a global economy. That message of move on, I think, just really is in amongst itself, excluding a lot of people and creating also a lot of fear, you know. And there are people who are like, wait, what do you move on? What does that mean for me? How am I going to move on? You know, and what does that look like? And yeah, by, I think, embracing that ambiguity, embracing the grief, the mourning that comes with and being okay with that, hopefully you're creating a more inclusive rebirth, if you will, where we'll be able to collectively solve problems and challenges together. But I think that brings, as we just have a few minutes left, and to that point of, yeah, the rebirth, the coming out the other end, okay, you know. And I think what we're learning in hearing your stories and the lessons is you got to hold that space a little bit, hold the ambiguity, hold some of that uncomfortableness to come out the other end a little bit stronger. Is how else do we embrace rebirth and focus on that once we feel like we've gone through the correct process? I mean, is it harnessing and using that to power you? How do we come out the other end stronger and more united?
Well, I wish I had an easier, clear answer to that. I think it's a great question. And I guess what I would say on that, and this, I guess I could say it very quickly by quoting one of my favorite quotes at the moment, which is that we we never become. We're always in a process of becoming. We never become. We're always in a process of becoming. And I think in the work that I do, and we talk about adaptive change, as I mentioned earlier when I introduced myself. Adaptive change tends to be the kind of change that doesn't just happen in your head. It happens in your heart, in your gut. It's about who you are in some cases. It's about norms and values, all that so-called soft stuff, although I think it's the hardest stuff there is in some ways. And so on that point, then, I think this shift in identity, right? I don't know about you with the loss of your mother. For me, when I lost my father, I became someone different, not 99% different, maybe 1% different. But that 1% was big enough that I could see that I had changed as a person. And the same thing happened even when I had my children. I have 3 children now. I am not the same person I was before I had children. I think I'm better. We could ask them.
Yeah, right.
TBD. My daughter in the back of the car. Maybe she'd have a different point of view. Getting married, similar. Or, you know, so there are all these moments in our lives, I think, where we do feel some kind of qualitative shift in who we are as people. And it's, you know, in those cases, at least for the better, it's actually a beautiful thing. And I'm glad I'm not the, you know, 17-year-old I used to be. So I think maybe one answer to your question is to tap into those moments where we've gone through this kind of adaptive change. And it could be at work as well. And when an organization goes through a rebranding process, which I know is a lot of the work that MAG focuses on, and some of the best designers that I've met through MAG are people who understand that design process, that branding process, isn't just about the technical work of getting a new logo or whatever it may be. It's really about holding a team through a process of becoming something different. That's where I think this world of design and branding is so beautiful, because you have a visual, literally beautiful, tangible product at the end of that. Whereas in my work, you know, it's a little bit more sublime, also powerful, but sublime. So I think, you know, one answer is just to tap into those moments where we've gone through change and really being willing to let go of that part of ourselves, or at least a part of ourselves that we thought we couldn't. You know, and it's that part that maybe served a purpose to get us through a moment in life or through a particular job, but no longer is fit for purpose. And so I think that willingness to let go and, in a sense, become, you know, have that identity shift in a way, is a part of how we embrace what's emerging.
That's really powerful, Eric. Yeah, I think that's really powerful. And right, know that you carry those experiences, those people, those changes, those things with you, and they become part of you and who you are, and your connection and the tie to the business side, I think, is very on point as well. You know, there's a Pablo Picasso quote that I won't get entirely correct, but it's to the effect of, you know, there is no creation without destruction, right? You're if you're creating something new, you are destroying something, an old website, an old way of thinking, an old way of doing something, you know, and getting okay with that, and knowing that that process, I think, as I'm hearing you say, lives with you and journeys with you. Well, yeah. I think you and I
one more thing on that, Zach,
of course,
wrap up. Well, and this is, I think perhaps one of the deepest griefs or fears that we hold, particularly in organizations. And I say this with the COVID crisis in mind, as people are losing jobs or fearful of that, but it's a sense that we are not needed. And particularly in an economic culture where we're often reduced to a job description, it's this fear that we are replaceable. And so, and this shows up in very obscene phrases like, we need to earn a living rather than seeing life as a gift. You don't have to earn your life or earn your living. It's something that you're given. You didn't ask for it, but someone cared for you long enough for you to get to where you are. You, me, and anyone who's listening to this podcast. So I think perhaps part of the, you know, the embracing too is a sense of gentleness toward yourself, a sense that of gratitude, perhaps not in a forced way, but in the way of really appreciating that you don't have to earn your way into this. It's not about being a better griever. And I'll tell you, it's not even about being a better leader. Because again, that's a muscle through it approach, which I think creates some of the same trauma that the causes of the problems we're struggling with in the first place. So I think that maybe the message I want to leave us on is this sense that that we are, I think, fundamentally whole. And that doesn't mean life is easy. doesn't mean that it's painless, but the whole is about embracing both that side as well as that more aspirational, you know, beautiful side too. And that to me is probably one of the more practical things that I do, you know, in my work, in my career. So I just wanted to share that.
Thank you. That's amazing. Yeah. We all owe ourselves a little bit of that grace and ease off some of the pressures that we all put on ourselves.
Yeah.
Right. Grace. Right. If we give ourselves the grace, then we're more likely to extend it to others too. And it's a really important reminder, Eric, especially in times of uncertainty and also in times of, you know, wanting to create change and improve things, that takes time and things take step by step. And just like with grief, you have to be okay not being okay. You know, I think that was some of the best advice that I got, was it's okay, Zach, to not feel okay. You can't also beat yourself up for that, or you can't be too tough on yourself because your company's changing or there's a new way of doing things, right? You need to extend that grace to not just others, but to ourselves as well.
That's right. And in leadership too. And for those, and I'm sure, and I would empathize for those on the, you know, listening to this podcast, to say, well, all this talk about grief and loss is fine, but it has nothing to do with the hard nose, hard knock realm of politics and organizational leadership. And, you know, and that may be true, but I would say just try it on. And if anything else, when you have someone coming at you in a way that might feel aggressive or deceitful, you know, if you come at it from a place of them not having processed some grief, maybe it gives you 2 seconds longer to have a more strategic response to that. So I just want to acknowledge in a very honoring way anyone who might be a bit skeptical that what we're talking about here has anything to do with organizational life and leadership.
Right. And to your point earlier, it can be a common ground, because we've all faced loss and grief in various forms. Right. So it can be disarming. And I think many people see that in losing a loss of a, you know, losing a loved one, and that loss, and finding a support group or a community. I think, you know, there's an organization called the Dinner Party that organizes dinners for 20 and 30 year olds who have faced loss. And once you get into a group like that, it's very disarming. You know, you have a common connection. And I think your point to tying that to the business and leadership space as well is very, very on point. So Eric, I want to thank you so much for the conversation today. I feel like we could go on for 6 more hours. So it's wonderful to have you join us, and I really appreciate the insights and you taking the time.
Thanks for having me, Zach.
Thanks for joining this episode of Mag's Mind. For more information about Mag, our community, and our work, please visit magcollective.com, magcollective.com. Thanks for listening, and until then,